Good morning, and welcome to LUMC's weekly worship service. We're so happy to have you join us this morning as we continue our series, The Chosen. Today, we're going to dive into episode 3 of season 3 of The Chosen and see a moment from the Bible where the people of Jesus' hometown try to kill him. Pastor Brandon is going to help us to see both why they did this and why this story might be way more relevant to our relationship with Jesus than we realize. But before that, we're going to begin our service with some music. Join me and let's sing together.
He's coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break, as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him. Oh, oh, oh. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
We're gonna sing, "For Who Can Stop the Lord?"
For who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 No one. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace.
Amen. Now, before we get into the rest of our service, I'd like to share with you a few announcements. Right now, take a look at that button on the right that says Connection Card. Go ahead and click that button and fill one out, even if you've filled one out before. The Connection Card is a great resource. It's a way to register your attendance and let us know that you're here with us today. It's a great way to take next steps and sign up for activities in the church. And most importantly, it's a way to share your prayer requests with us. Every Monday, Pastor Brandon prays over all of the prayer requests we get and will reach out to you to let you know that he's prayed for you. So please take a moment right now to fill that out. Now, after you've done that, go ahead and click the link that says Give Online. Every week, our church is blessed to be able to change lives through our online ministry, like this worship service, and through our work in the community. That impact is made possible through your gifts, so thank you so much for giving. And if you'd like to continue to support the work of LUMC, click that link and you'll see a variety of ways that you can give. Finally, next Sunday, we will be having our fall festival right after church. There will be delicious food, cornhole, a petting zoo, a bounce house, and so much more. So that we can make sure we have enough food, let us know that you're coming by checking that box on your connection card. We hope to see you there. Now, for this week's message, we're going to dive into episode 3 of season 3 of The Chosen and see a moment from the Bible where the people of Jesus' hometown try to kill him. Pastor Brandon is going to help us to see both why they did this and why this story might be way more relevant to our relationship with Jesus than we realize. Let's watch.
What's the most trouble you ever got into when you were a kid? I mean, I feel like we all do something as kids that gets us in trouble. Maybe you got a ticket when you were a teenager, or you ruined some furniture as a kid. I mean, I remember some of the biggest trouble I ever got into was when I called the Hulk Hogan hotline. Do you guys remember things like that? Like 1-900 numbers that you could call that would cost you $5 for the first minute and like 50 cents every minute after that? Well, one day, my cousins and I decided to give Hulk Hogan a call, right? The only problem was we were afraid we'd get in trouble. So we'd call the number, right? And then he'd start talking, and then we'd hang up. And then we'd call again, right? Listen a few seconds, and then we'd hang up. And we did this probably a dozen times. And nobody knew until my dad got the bill, right? First minute charge, another first minute charge, another first minute charge, $5, $5, $5. I mean, needless to say, me and Hulk, we don't get to talk too much anymore, right? Because we all got in trouble. But I can tell you one thing. I've never gotten in so much trouble that my family said, I'm gonna kill you. And I don't mean that as a euphemism. Like, I mean literally, like, I will kill you. That's never happened to me. But it did happen to Jesus. And today, as we look at episode 3 of season 3 of The Chosen, I want to show you both why it happened and why we should be so thankful that Jesus got in trouble like this. Right? So let's dive in. In episode 3, we get a glimpse into a typical synagogue service in the first century. Right? Jesus goes back to Nazareth, and The Chosen highlights some very critical moments and details about this service in this scene. But there's also much more to this service than that needs further explanation, right? And that also further explains what's happening in the scene and why Jesus' actions are so controversial. You see, Matthew's gospel tells us Jesus traveled throughout the region of Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. And when we look at the archaeology of the other synagogues of this region, as well as ancient Jewish literature, we get a better sense of how exactly this service unfolded. You see, one of the first things Jesus and others would have done before they even entered the synagogue was purify themselves in something called a mikveh. Now, a mikveh was a large ritual bath intended for ritual cleansing. You would cleanse your head, your heart, your hands, and your feet. And this was an act meant to prepare you for worship. It could also be a time of repentance, right? And then once you'd entered the synagogue, unless you were directed, you would either sit on the floor or you would stand around the periphery of the room. The only people who were seated in actual seats were those who were invited to sit in what were called the chief seats. Chief seats were reserved for people of honor in the community. They were specifically distributed, right? They weren't intended just for the rich and the wealthy. They were also given to younger people of promise or elders in the community, or even those who had done something particularly noble or important. And so these seats also came with a responsibility. To accept a space in a chief seat was to accept an important role in the community at large. And then after everyone had taken their place, a person from within the community would be asked to lead the service that day. Sometimes this was a visiting rabbi, but other times it was simply a person from within that community. And it was absolutely normal for laypersons to lead the service in this particular way. Because what this person would do is this person in charge would receive the scroll for that day from the Torah closet, and they would stand on something called a bema as they read it. The scripture that this person would read would have been predetermined, right? Part of a lectionary. And then once he finished reading, he would have sat down in this thing called a Moses seat and shared his thoughts on this scripture. And after he finished, there would be time for the congregation to question and discuss. So as Jesus leads the service in Nazareth that day, no one is surprised that he reads from Isaiah, right? This was the passage for the day, so Jesus didn't choose it. But what surprises and concerns the congregation is what he says in his remarks from the Moses seat. See, Luke tells us, then he rolled up the scroll, he gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They asked. So at first, the crowd is overjoyed when Jesus says that the Isaiah passage is fulfilled. You see, Nazareth is a town of people descended from King David. The term Nazareth is actually related to the Hebrew word netzer, which means a young branch or a shoot. It's a word connected to the practice of pruning an olive tree all the way down to its stump. And immediately the stump will begin to grow back, right? That part that grows back is the netzer. It's the shoot that will become a new branch. Well, this is what Isaiah is talking about when he says, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. Nazareth, as a community, believes that they're part of this prophecy. They believe that there are people who are preparing children to be the Messiah. Which is why, in Luke's account, when Jesus claims that he's the Messiah, the people aren't angry or upset. They're actually overjoyed. I mean, Luke says that they are amazed by his gracious words. They believe that the Messiah is coming from their hometown, right? This is Joseph's boy. And that this is going to be a special blessing for their community. But this is where things take a turn. Because as Jesus is sitting in the Moses seat, as this conversation is happening around the room, Jesus rebukes them, right? Instead of saying, yes, right? For you people who raised me in the faith, there will be a special blessing now that I have revealed myself as the Messiah. Instead of saying that, he says that this blessing is actually going to go to somebody else. And this is where the conversation would have happened that follows the message from the person in the Moses seat, right? Where everybody begins to talk about what they just said. But then Jesus rebukes them. And he does so by referencing two situations involving the Old Testament prophets. And this is one of those times where Scripture is imploring us to go back and study. I mean, so often we read these references to the Old Testament Scriptures mentioned in the Gospels, and we just move on. But in order to understand what Jesus is saying, we have to study what he's referencing. I mean, much of his Jewish audience had memorized these scriptures, right? Just a line or two could bring to mind an entire passage. But if we're not familiar with scripture, then we need to go back and we need to look at the entire passage that he's drawing our attention to. And when we do, we'll find one major common denominator between these two passages. Because both the passage from 1 Kings, where Elijah helps the Gentile widow, and the 2 Kings passage where Elisha heals a Gentile named Naaman, well, they're similar not only in their inclusion of Gentiles, but more importantly, in the state of the Israelite people as these events unfold. Because in both cases, when God is blessing the Gentiles, the Israelite people have turned their hearts away from the Lord, right? They need to repent. This is what Jesus is implying that makes Nazareth's crowd so angry. He's telling them that just because he comes from their town, that doesn't mean that they'll be blessed. He's telling them that they need to repent, right? They and the Jewish people as a whole are lost. And while he's leaving the door open for them to return their hearts to the Lord and receive him not only as their military Messiah, but also as their spiritual Savior, he's also letting them know that this gift isn't exclusively for them. Right? Just as God reached out to the Gentiles when the Israelites had turned away from the Lord, Jesus is going to do the same thing now. And the people of Nazareth do not like this message. I mean, Luke tells us that they got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. Now, what's so crazy about this moment is that these aren't just his neighbors who are doing this. Right? This isn't just his community. This crowd is also likely filled with his family, his aunts, uncles, and cousins. I mean, he would have had relatives in this community. And mind you, Nazareth is not a large community, maybe 100 to 400 people. But they are so upset, so repulsed by his message that they try to banish him to death. I mean, this is at the heart of what's happening in Nazareth, what leads to this heartbreaking and life-altering moment in Jesus' ministry. That had to be a hard moment for Jesus, don't you think? I mean, telling his community that not all of them would experience salvation? I mean, maybe some people were easier than others, right, to say that to, but that had to be hard. I mean, this is Jesus' family. These are his neighbors. He grew up with these people. And think about what Jesus has to tell them. He has to look at all of them and say, your hearts are misguided, and you need to repent. The Lord is no longer your first love, and something needs to change. I mean, let me ask you, right? How many of you feel like Jesus would be talking to you when he says that? You used to love the Lord, but if you're honest, the Lord just isn't first in your life anymore. Sports are more important, or work is more important, or scrolling through Instagram, if we're measuring by amount of time spent doing things, right, has proven more important in your life. How many of you could look back at your calendar right now and say to yourself, if I'm being judged by my calendar and how I spend my time, then Jesus definitely isn't first in my life? I mean, let me be honest, right? That feeling stinks. I mean, it's like the time that I stole something when I was a kid and I just felt sick, right? Like I couldn't eat that night. I couldn't focus. I ended up having to tell my parents because the punishment of doing it was nowhere near as bad as the guilt that was eating at me. No one wants to feel that way. But have you ever noticed how we handle that guilt as we get older? As we get older, the guilt doesn't drive us to confess. The guilt drives us to fight back. And that's actually lesson one today. Lesson one is that sin leads to guilt and guilt leads to anger. Sin leads to guilt and guilt leads to anger. I mean, be honest, right? Have you ever gotten mad at someone who made you feel guilty? Not because they were wrong, right? But because you just couldn't stand the way that it made you feel. I mean, they were right. You knew that you needed to change, but that feeling was so uncomfortable, you took it out on them. That's what happens in Jesus's community, right? He's not wrong. They might even realize that he's not wrong, but that doesn't change the way it makes them feel, right? And that doesn't change the fact that they don't want it to be true. And so they fight back. I mean, it makes me think of what happens every time I wake up really tired, right? My wife looks at me and she says the same thing every time. She says, well, if you came to bed when I did, you wouldn't be so tired. And you know the worst thing about that answer? She's right, right? And I hate that, but it's true. And what it forces me to realize is our second lesson, which is lesson two, and that is to get rid of the anger, we must get rid of the sin. And to get rid of the sin, we must repent. To get rid of the anger, we must get rid of the sin, and to get rid of the sin, we must repent. Now, it may not be a sin to stay up late, right? But the staying up late is what causes my pain. And let's be honest, right? There's a sin in our lives that's causing us pain. I mean, you can probably name it, right? Odds are our spouses can name it better than we can. They know what's causing us pain in our lives. Our kids can name it. Our parents can even probably name it for us sometimes. God can certainly name it. And we hate that feeling. But in the end, the answer isn't to get mad at our family or to get mad at God. The only real answer is to repent, right? To turn our backs on whatever or whoever it is and get that thing out of our lives. But that's easier said than done, isn't it? Because the truth is, as bad as that harmful thing is in our lives, whatever it might be, as much havoc as it might be causing, we're comfortable with it. And we'll stick with what's comfortable, even if it's awful. Right? It's like how when I was in high school, right, long sideburns suddenly became popular. And so going with the trend, right, I started to grow my sideburns out. The only problem was mine didn't just grow down, they grew out, right? And instead of looking like the fashionable guys you saw on television, I looked like this. A sad young man who could not go to prom that year, right? Just not gonna get a date. And here's the craziest thing. After a while, I knew it. I knew I looked awful. I knew that I should cut them, but I didn't. Because it was in that moment that I learned our third lesson today, which is that the biggest obstacle to our repentance is our comfort. The biggest obstacle to our repentance is our comfort, right? I was comfortable with those sideburns. They were awful, but they were the awful that I knew. And let's be honest, right? This is supposed to be a funny story about the sideburns, but for some of you, the awful that you know isn't funny at all. Right? There's something you desperately need to give up in your life, but you can't because it's just too comfortable. Maybe it's a relationship you really need to get out of, or a habit that you really need to break, or some sin that's tearing your family apart. But the comfort, the fear of change, it's holding you back. Well, if that's you today, I want you to hear these words. God wants to set you free. Right? This is not where you're meant to be. This is not the life that God wants for you. And Jesus died so that you could be set free. For some of you, you need to hear these words right now, right? You might feel too awful to change. You might feel not strong enough to change. You might feel not worthy of change. But here's the real truth. You don't have to be. Because the one who died on the cross and rose from the grave, Jesus, he is worthy. And it's not by your strength that you're going to overcome these things. It's by his strength. You see, the real problem for the people in Capernaum wasn't that they weren't faithful to the Lord. It's that they couldn't repent. The Messiah was standing in their midst, right? He could have saved them right there. But instead of repenting, they lashed out. And today, I want to give you the opportunity to do the opposite. I want to give you the opportunity to overcome these obstacles in your life. Get rid of these sins and this pain that's hurting you. I want to give you the opportunity to repent and turn these things over to Jesus. And so today on your connection card, you'll see that there are these opportunities to begin your relationship with Jesus, right? Really commit your heart to Jesus or to recommit it, maybe if you've strayed, and to renew that relationship with Jesus. Whatever it is, I want to invite you to just check that box, right? Whatever it is that God is calling you to do, to take that step and say, God, I'm not going to try to fix this anymore. I'm not going to try to hide in this sin anymore. I'm done being comfortable. And instead, I need you. I need you to come in and heal what is broken inside of me. I need you to forgive that thing that is bringing me so much guilt, and I need your help to change. And so I want to invite you to take that step today, whatever that might be. If there's something specific you want me to be praying for in your life, put that on your connection card, and I'll be lifting that up this week. In fact, right now, as you take this step, let me pray for you right now. God, we know that we are not perfect. We know that there are things in our lives that we're way too comfortable with, things that are drawing us away from you, things that are bringing us harm and the people around us harm. But God, we don't want to be like the people in Capernaum. We don't want to lash out in those moments. We want to repent. And so we come and we lay these things before you right now, Lord, and we confess them to you. And we ask that you will heal us, that you will save us. Lord, we put our hope in you, that you are the one who can do what we cannot. You can forgive the sins that we can't overcome, that you can make us clean and you can make us new. And so we give our hearts to you right now, putting our full trust in you and in the power of Jesus' name. And it's in that name we pray. Amen.
Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. So loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of Jesus is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power so love, God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him for the wonders of his love.
the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Well, that's it for our service today. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. If you haven't already done so, please take a moment to check out all of those links to the side and down below. Fill out a connection card, sign up for a group, and give online. We're so glad that you decided to be with us today, and we'd like to personally invite you back next week as we continue our series, The Chosen. Today, we're going to end with one of our special benediction songs, so let's join together and sing.